Good evening, good evening. This is Pastor Byron Graham, Senior Pastor of Lighthouse Christian Center. Happy Wednesday to you. Thank you for joining us. And as always, it is a privilege and honor to have the opportunity to share with you God's amazing word. We hope that everyone has had a great week in the Lord. We're certainly moving right along. It's hump day, and we got a little rain today, so it helped to cool things off. So as always, we're excited about this opportunity to share God's word. It's a privilege. And you go, I think, 7 days without the word makes 1 week. has a couple of meanings there. So we thank God for this opportunity. Let's go to God in prayer. Father, once again, we thank you. We give you honor, glory, and praise. We thank you for your presence this evening in the person of the Holy Spirit. We ask you to teach us, lead us, and guide us into your truth. Help us to comprehend your word so we can live the life you called us to live, so we can give you glory, honor, and praise. We give you thanksgiving. We praise and thank you in advance for this opportunity to be a blessing to your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. All right, the only announcement we have that I want to make you aware of, we will be resuming children's church real soon. We had a blast this past Sunday. And we thank God for all the people who came out. And as we continue on our series with family, we were able to touch on a lot of subjects. So we pray it was a blessing to your life. We'll be back at the Fort this Sunday, 10 o'clock a.m. Fort Dorchester is located at 8500 Patriot Boulevard in North Charleston. So come out. We would love for you to be a part of a live in-person worship service. If you don't have a church home, great time to visit. I would encourage every believer to make sure you are part of a good community of faith. We need each other. We are absolutely better together. And so if you don't have a church on, we would love for you to come and visit LCC. Let's go to a brief time of praise and worship, and then we will get back and get into tonight's lesson.
You're glad this morning. We bless your name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We give him glory.
All right, and we are glad. Hey, snippet from our service this past Sunday. If you enjoyed that, you ought to come enjoy a full service, start to finish. We would love to see you there. All right, let's get into our lesson this evening. I want to continue to share the lines of family. We've been on this subject, very important subject. Just a lot to get into as it relates to family. We can talk about this all day long, but I want to try to focus on just a singular thought tonight that applies to family. So tonight I want to talk about communication. Communication, obviously, we know communication is talking, exchanging information, ideas, or news. And obviously communication is a critical part of building a strong family. And that's the goal of our series. We want to build stronger families and so that we're glorifying God in our homes. And part of how we do that will be communicating with those members of our family. Communication can be verbal, nonverbal. It involves speaking, but it also involves listening. We want to look at Psalms 141, verses 1 through 3. This is out of the New Living Translation. Psalms 141, 1 through 3. This is David. He says, "Oh Lord, I'm calling to you. Please hurry. Listen when I cry to you for help. Accept my prayer as incense offered to you and my upraised hands as an evening offering." I want to focus on verse number 3. So he says, "Take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips." Right, so that is a powerful statement. And so with that thought, we want to dive into the whole idea of communication and family. So I found a couple things that stood out to me, data, statistics, quotes. This first one comes from the Daily Mirror. This is a something that was written in the Daily Mirror. This is a magazine in London. And it said married couples, and I think some of these I may have mentioned before, but I think it bears repeating. It says married couples have nothing more to say to each other after 8 years. According to a study, Professor Hans Jurgens asked 5,000 German husbands and wives how often they talk to each other. After 2 years of marriage, most of them managed 2 or 3 minutes of chat over breakfast, more than 20 minutes after an evening meal, and more, and a few more minutes in bed. By the 6th year, that was down to 10 minutes a day. And a state of almost total speechlessness was reached by the 8th year of marriage. Ouch. That's pretty tough. Focus on the Family, January 1990, page number 8, says a survey by the American Sociological Review stated that working women said they talk with their husbands an average of 12 minutes a day. All right. So again, we see a lack of communication. Joe White in Homemade. This is November 1989. A recent survey by America's most popular teen magazine revealed that only 4.1% of teenage girls in America feel they could go to their father to talk about a serious problem. Even more recently, USA Today published an eye-opening results of a study of teens under stress. And when asked where they would turn for help in a crisis, the most popular choice was music. Second was peers. Third was TV. Amazing as it may sound, moms were down the list at number 31 and dads were number 48. So, you know, those are some alarming statistics. It kind of hurts to read this, but clearly communication breaks down over time in our homes, in our families, in our marriages, with our children. Communication is critical. It's very important. Think about this. You know, as believers, we know we're told to pray. And prayer is just communicating to God. And We know if we don't pray, we're not going to have a relationship with God. It's just not going to happen. We have to, you know, relationships are based on communication. If we're going to have a solid relationship with God, then we need to pray. We need to talk to him. We need to communicate with him. And if we're going to have a solid relationship with our family, we have to communicate. Now, we see this even in the world of business, on the job, with our careers. You know, companies, they have sense enough to know that every so often they have meetings. You know, they talk, they communicate, they talk about the vision of the company. They talk about important announcements. They talk about, you know, pertinent information that everyone needs to know. And it just helps to create a cohesive environment. You know, I've heard the statement that you have to kind of run your family like a business. I don't know if I completely agree with that, but there are some things that businesses do that can be applied to family. You can suggest having, you know, family meetings, you know, talking about goals and where you want to do, talking about complaints, you know, grievances, you know, making sure everyone is on the same page, you know, getting feedback, getting the voice of what's happening among all members of the family. So that means as you know, husbands, wives, parents, we should regularly meet and talk about what everyone is thinking about, you know, what things you're upset about, what things you want to see in our family, what are we doing right, what are we doing wrong. And so if we're going to get everyone on the same page, we have to communicate. Sometimes as men, we're not very good at this. Women, you can argue, are better communicators than men. So as men, leaders of the home, we have to be intentional about this. We have to put forth a little bit more effort and make sure everyone is on the same page. If we're leading, we have a vision, we have to communicate that vision. If there are issues and problems, if there's things that need to be addressed, we need to talk about it. We need to hash it out. And so we know it is important that we communicate to members of our family for various reasons. It number one, it shows respect, because we know communication is not just speaking, but it's also listening. So you can get the ear of and the voice and the opinions of other members of your family. It provides clarity. It helps build trust, camaraderie. Communication helps to inform others. If there's some important things going on in the house, in the family, or in your life, in your spouse's life, in your children's life, you know, kids may have things going on at school or something happening in their personal life with their, you know, peer pressure, things going on with their friends. So it informs everyone else what's happening in your life. And we know communication is a very important part of team building. We see this in athletics, but also as a family, you know, we're a team. Church families, we're a team. We have to communicate. We have to talk. It's critical. This is something we have to do. I can recall some meetings we had, you know, church staff, and man, I came away with a great sense. It just felt great. And just to kind of know what was going on and to get the opinions of other people. Sometimes you just don't know what people are thinking until you ask them. And there's some times in the family where I, you know, thinking that I was going to rock the boat or just didn't want to, you know, start a, you know, confrontation or argument. And I said, you know, I just wanted to be honest and share some things. And after the fact, I was glad I did, because, you know, I think Satan tries to manipulate us in our thinking to get us so we won't communicate and spend time talking to the people who are closest to us. There's incredible value in communicating. And again, this is the foundation for every relationship. And so here in this passage, David, now this is known as a psalm of, it's a prayer of safekeeping from wickedness. And so David is praying to God. He's referencing, as you read the whole passage, his enemies and what he wants God to do. And so he's saying, God, I'm calling to you. Please hurry. I need your help. You know, accept my prayer as incense, my hands upraised as an evening offering. Then in the middle of all this, he talks about something that I think we can apply to our topic this month. He said, take control of what I say. You know, sometimes we pray and we can vent and say things and say things we don't mean. And, you know, sometimes to God or to each other. So he's asking God for help. He says, take control of what I say, O Lord, and guard my lips. And I think what he says here can be applied to our family, and it can be applied to when we communicate with the members of our family. He's asking God for help with his words and with his mouth. Obviously, when it comes to our family, the frequency in which we communicate is very important. In other words, you know, you can't talk to your spouse or talk to your children or talk to your parents or talk to your family members today and not talk to them for another 12 months. You know, the relationship is going to break down. I think people probably see this when, you know, the dating or even marriage where, you know, two people are away from each other for a very long time. It's very hard to maintain that relationship, especially when there's a distance between the two of you, or in terms of proximity, or you just don't have an opportunity to talk. Now, technology makes it a little easy, sometimes too easy. You know, it can help or hurt, you know, communication. But the reality is, if you're not communicating frequently, any relationship is going to break down. Not only that, not only frequency, but how we communicate is important. Tone and delivery, okay? Our tone of voice. Obviously, we said communication is also nonverbal. So, you know, how we communicate with our family members is important. We have to communicate to them or with them with respect. And it makes all the difference in the world. It's not what you say, it's how you say it. And so this is important. In fact, I thought about this when I was studying. The Bible says in Proverbs 16:24, I don't have it up here, but Bible says sweet words are like honeycomb, sweet to the soul, health to the bones. One translation said pleasant words. There are a lot of verses I could have used tonight. Colossians 4:6 or 4:16, it talks about let your words, you know, be with grace, seasoned with salt, you know, so you know how to answer every person. So the Bible talks about, you know, tone, delivery. Your words should be sweet. Your words should be seasoned with salt, should be respectful. This is critical. We live in a day and age. We just don't know how to talk to people. I mean, I just go ahead and put it out there. We don't know how to talk to people. We just say anything that comes to our mind. And, you know, not to bring this up, it's amazing. You know, we're in an election year and politics. Now, I understand this competition, man, but I don't know how we've arrived at this point. I mean, politics were always competitive. I just don't know if it was this vicious before. But we just talk about anybody, any kind of way. It's like we have no filter. We have no boundaries. And, you know, we're all Americans. I mean, we're all Americans. And when you think about that in the context of a family, like we're all related. You know, we're all, you know, in the same home. Even among Christians, you know, like we're in the same body. We serve the same God, we have the same Lord and Savior. Like, why would we talk to each other in certain ways? You know, we have to, and I'm not saying it's easy, but we have to learn how to talk to people with respect. We need to treat people the way we want to be treated, and it's going to take a lot from us. Now, David said here, and this kind of brings us to this verse, he said, take control of what I say. And so primarily we see we must get our mouths and our words under control. He said, take control. He said, I need control. We have to control ourselves when we're communicating to members of our family. We just have to get under control. We have to have a filter. I mean, it's all about discipline. You know, we just can't fly off at the handle. You know, we have two ears, one mouth. We need to think twice before we speak once. Words do hurt, and they can damage relationships. And notice what David said. He said, take control of what I say. Now, here's the thing. We cannot control what other people say, but we do have control on what we say. And so he said, I need to get under control what comes out of my mouth. This also means we should avoid, all right, using profanity, insults. You know, you got a lot of Christians who curse, use profanity all the time. You know, we have to get that under control because we talk just like the world and we lose that sense of respect and credibility. So we need to control that. Again, avoid using profanity, insults, tearing other people down with our words. You know, even if there's a disagreement, we got to, you know, do it. You don't cross that line. You know, just, you know, be respectful. Be sensitive. Be mindful of what you say. Once we say things, we cannot get it back. And the thing is, when we say certain things, we could apologize, but the damage has been done. And, prayerfully they will forgive us. But if we're not careful, certain things we say can damage relationships to where what we say is catastrophic. I mean, it just does so much damage. And all the damage control in the world sometimes will not help. And unfortunately, if you say certain things, because it's not just based upon how you feel, it's based upon what the other person feels. And when you say certain things, you may not be able to come back from it. So we have to be very careful of what we utter to others, especially when we're upset, when we're heated. Again, easier said than done. But that's why David, now I tell you what, David, we got to commend him because he's praying. He says, take control of what I say. Most people don't pray prayers like this, asking God to help them take control over their words. A lot of people don't pray this, but David did, man after God's own heart. We pray for stuff, things, cars, houses, raises, promotions, husbands, wives. But he says, please help me with my words. Help me get control over what I say, because I believe David understood how powerful our words are. And control, this is discipline. And keep in mind now, if we're growing in Christ, we should have more control. Self-control is a fruit of the Spirit. And so if we're growing and we're living under the control of the Holy Spirit, it should cause us to have more control over what we say. He said, take control of what I say, O Lord. And so we also, again, we have to ask God. This is what David did. We have to ask God and look to the Lord for help. Again, this is what he did. We have to look to the Lord. He said, take control of what I say, O Lord. So we have to look to God for help when we're communicating to members of our family. Now, some of us need more help than others. some of us, we our mouth is something. I remember there's a preacher wrote a book, I believe it was Joyce Meyers. She wrote a book entitled Me and My Big Mouth. She said, I needed a whole lot of help with my mouth. And some of us, we like that. We rattle off at the handle, we keep going. I remember there was one time, I was, going back and forth. I'm a talker, if you haven't noticed. And it's like the Spirit of God told me to shut up. It's just like the Spirit of God said, just be quiet, be quiet, quit talking so doggone much. And sometimes we need that. Sometimes I think we do things in the context of relationships and we don't realize we're doing it, or we just are in denial. And sometimes it takes someone saying something to us, sometimes it takes God telling us something. I remember David, God had a prophet to confront David. Sometimes we lack self-awareness. We just don't realize what we're doing. We said a couple of weeks ago, some of us may not be the easiest people to live with. Maybe some of us, that's the first time we've heard that. But a lot of times we lack self-awareness. Fortunately, David, he was aware. He said, no, I know I need help. Lord, help me. Take control of what I say. I need your help. And so when it comes to communication, we have to look to God for help. Some people, they've cursed all their life and now they're saved. And so they need God to help them. I mean, they've cursed all their life. They grew up around cursing. I work with kids nowadays and the language is terrible. It's horrible. It's horrible. That's what they grow up around. That's what they hear when they go home. And so when someone comes to give their life to Jesus, sometimes they need a little bit more help. Some people need more help than others because it's natural. They've been doing it so long, and it's going to take God to help them walk away from that behavior and that lifestyle, because that's not a way to carry yourself as a child of God. The Bible talks about us controlling our words, our lips, several places of scripture, it says that. And at the end of the day, we're representing God. We're ambassadors for Christ. We're salt. We're the light of the world. And so, if you're treating people with respect, you're not going to talk to them that way. And, when you just specifically talk about expletives, And I tell kids that, you know, you can't go to a job interview talking like that. You can't be in a business meeting talking like that. They're not going to treat you. They're not going to take you seriously. You know, they're going to think you have a very limited vocabulary. And I get it. Sometimes we say things out of anger. And so David recognized this and he said, Lord, please take control of what I say. I need your help. And there's nothing wrong with admitting that God, like, all right, I said some things I didn't need to say. Sometimes I go off and I'm out in left field and I do things that do not honor you. Like, help me with this. And I believe God will help us. David, he reached out to God. And here's the thing. The Bible says God will help us by his spirit. And in the New Testament, in the book of James, it talks about how the tongue, no man can tame. Like, we need help. You know, it takes help. And sometimes there's a lot of hypocrisy among Christians, you know, because the Bible says with in one breath we bless God and in the next breath we curse our family members or we curse our fellow man. And, you know, that's not a good look. And the bad thing is the people who live with us, they see that. Again, no one's perfect, but we need to have some self-awareness that if we have problems in this area, especially when we're communicating to members of our family, especially when we're heated and we're upset, we have to ask God to give us some help. And so that's what David did. He said, Lord, I need you to take control of what I say. I give you permission to work on me. I give you permission to help strengthen me. I need to get under control. And if we're growing in Christ, spending time in the Word, getting a consistent diet of the Word of God, spending time in prayer, we should be living under the control of the Holy Spirit. It's going to impact what we say and how we communicate. Now, we're specifically talking about the how. You know, I do want to stress it is important that the frequency is there because we have to take time to talk to. I mean, I can do a better job too. I mean, I put it out there. We got to do a better job talking to our family members. And we live in a world full of distractions, you know, TV, technology, computers, cell phones, and, you know, our schedules. We work, you know, sometimes we work and we're out of balance with our work schedules. Again, some of us work way too much. Some of us work too little. And sometimes our priorities are out of whack. So we have to spend time talking to our families, asking, you know, them how their day went, what's going on in their life. And we have to be intentional about it. And if we're not good at that, we need to practice this just like we practice anything else. And we ask God for help. And so finally, Bible says, take control of what I say. This is David. He said, I need you to take control. I need to get my words under control. I can't be out of control. And I need to look to God for help. And he said, Lord, I want you to guard my lips. And so we also, if we're going to learn how to communicate, if our families are going to thrive, if our relationships are going to be strong, we have to ask God to guard our lips when communicating with our family. Now, here's the thing. This is what I found. This oftentimes takes a sensitivity to the Holy Spirit, which means you have to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, which means you need to be born of the Spirit, filled with the Spirit. You need to be consciously aware of his presence. I found sometimes the Holy Spirit will come and check you when you're starting to say things that is off base, when you're starting to say things that are going to hurt someone else, that when you're starting to say things that will defame someone's character, when you're starting to say things that will not honor him. And so he says, and this is the guard that God puts on your lips. The Holy Spirit will check you. Pastor Graham, what do you mean by that phrase, check? I used to hear that years ago from a lot of pastors and preachers. And I believe I understood it, but I wasn't completely sure. And a check is like a stop sign that God, he puts in your spirit. You know it's there. You feel it. You know it. And it's like, and I've had this happen to me where I started to talk and the Holy Spirit checked me like, stop. And maybe I was getting ready to talk about someone else who I did not need to talk about. Maybe I was about to talk about something that I really didn't have full information about and was about to spread misinformation. I've specifically heard this in times because if you're not careful as a Christian, you can gossip. Where the Spirit of God checked me. And I tell you what, you want to destroy a relationship, friends, you want to destroy, you know, church relationships, family, marriages. Start all the talking about people and our gossip in general, the Spirit of God will check you, okay? Because he doesn't want us to participate. You're on the job at work. huddles at work, talking about the supervisor, talking about your colleagues and whatnot, talking about things that, you're not part of the solution. You're just being part of the problem, making the problem bigger. And so God, in essence, will ask you to be the bigger person, be the adult in the room, and the Spirit of God will check you. Now, here's the thing. When he does check you, he puts that stop sign, that warning sign, that stop sign in your spirit. You got to obey, okay? And there's been some times where I felt that check, and afterwards I said, God, forgive me. I shouldn't have said that. I shouldn't have said that. That's when you get a B. When you get an A, the times when I was saying something and I felt the Spirit of God check me, and immediately I stopped. That's what you got to do. Because here's the thing. You never know what damage you can do with what you say. You never know. You may be saying something that's completely false about someone else, and you're kind of putting it out there. And so David said, I need you to guard my lips. And that should be our prayer. Silence can never be misquoted. Sometimes there's value in just not saying anything. And it takes a lot of discipline. It takes a lot of self-control. It takes a lot of obeying the voice leading and what the Holy Spirit will do. And friends, he absolutely will check you. And see, that's the thing no one else sees. Only you and God know that. And that's the thing, the general public, family members, and that's a very personal thing. And only God knows whether you obey him or not when you check him. And that's the thing. That's a story and a message by itself. Like, oh, so-and-so loves God so much, they're so obedient. You don't know that. You don't know about the 9 things God told him to do that day, and 8 of them, that individual just ignored it. Now, this is real talk here. And so sometimes the Holy Spirit will check you. Our job is to be an obedient Christian. And when the Holy Spirit starts to put that guard on your lips, like you submit, you yield, and you just stop talking. Now, that's the best thing to do. And so sometimes you're about to fly off at the handle, or you're going to say something that is going to really hurt the relationship. You got to be sensitive enough. Now, it's not all the time he'll do this. The word in itself should tells us we should be encouraging and loving when we speak with our words and our actions. But there are some times the Holy Spirit will check you and say, all right, now you're out of bounds now. You're completely out of bounds. You don't need to go there. And so that's what David was praying. He said, Lord, please guard my lips. And again, most people don't even pray a prayer like this, but we should. Lord, and that should be our prayer. Lord, take control of what I say. Please guard my lips. So communication is very important. It's critical. Again, frequency, tone, delivery. It's work. I told you all before. I mean, married 21 years. I feel like I'm just catching my stride, got, kids, 2 kids, and working on, things with that, on the job, relationships at church, just trying to be a better communicator. Being a better communicator is just speaking in public. Being a better communicator is being able to communicate with members of your family. I'll say this in close. I remember when I was playing basketball, I had a coach, and he would teach offense and teach defense. And I distinctly remember him saying, like, gentlemen, when you're on defense, he said, if you're not communicating, you're really not playing defense. And he said, you can be out there moving around, waving hands. But he said, if you're not communicating, because there's 5 guys on your team, you got to talk. You got to talk to them. If you're not talking, you're not doing your job. You got to let people know, hey, shooter's coming through. Hey, watch the lob. Watch, he's going back door, screen coming. I mean, and I had to learn that over time, because when I played beforehand, lower leagues, I wasn't really talking. I was just out there by myself, like on an island. He said, no, you can't do that. You guys got to be working together as one, not like this, but like this. And so to do that, to work collectively as a team, you got to communicate. Someone comes to screen you. Did you call out the screen? Someone come and just knock your teammate over. You didn't say anything to them. Like, what kind of teammate are you? Like, if you're not talking, you're not playing defense. And in a similar sense, in a family, if we're not communicating, we're not building, we're not strengthening our family. We're just not. Like, we're not. We're just there. We're not strengthening our relationships at all if we're not communicating. Think about this. Can you imagine going to church and never talking to anybody? You just go listen to the sermons. And then as soon as the benediction is made, you go out and talk to one person. Like, you're not building a strong church family. Same thing, you know, on the job, you know, you're on a, you know, working on a project with colleagues and y'all never meet, never talk. You're not going to get a job. It's not going to be done right. It's not going to be done well. And in a similar sense, in a family, we got to learn this. I'll put my hand up first, go to the front of the line. If we're not communicating, we're not strengthening our family. We're just not. It's just like our relationship with God. If we're not talking to him, you're not strengthening your relationship with God. And so communication is key. It is critical. You know, I see that with sports, but it applies to families, church families on the job as well, children, spouse, you know, parents, you know, communication, can't stress that enough. It is key. David saw it here, and we see it in our personal lives as well. So this week, let's challenge ourselves again. Let's make a point to talk to our family members and frequently, but also our tone, our delivery, how we say things to them. Calm down before we talk. You know, when we get angry, think twice before we speak once. Sometimes we want to just reply, respond. And it takes a very mature individual just to not say nothing when you want to fire back. You know, that's a different level of growth there. We just be calm, you know, and some things you just need to let it go. Like some things don't require a response. You just let it go. That's called meekness. And as we said in the family, at the end of the day, our goal is to be more like Jesus. So, you know, some things require a response. Some things don't. Just let it go and allow God to deal with it and just kind of move on. And so that's what we need to do as it relates to family. And that's a very important element behind communication. All right. About that time, let's go to God in prayer. Father, we bless you. We praise you. We honor you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for your help tonight. God, we thank you. We need you. And help us, Lord. And we pray the same thing that David prayed. Lord, you know, control our mouth, guard our lips. Help us to get control over what we say. Help us to talk to our family members frequently and respectfully. We give you praise, honor, and glory. We pray for all our families, all of our relationships, personal, private, domestic, professional, and church. Lord, help us to communicate early and often and with respect. At the end of the day, help us become more and more like your son, Jesus. We thank you. We love you. We honor you. And help us, Lord, to communicate more with you. We need to do so. Help us to understand how important it is that we talk and share and relate to others in love. We thank you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Thank you so very much. Hey, I want to let you know, I appreciate you. I appreciate you. Don't take you for granted at all. Thank you for your connection to this ministry. Those who come in person, those who follow us online, thank you. Hey, share this with your friends, loved ones. You know, feel free, you know, to share this link, the video, post it, you know, on social media page, whatever the case may be. And again, we would love to see you this Sunday, 10 o'clock a.m., not 10 o'clock sharp now. We 10 o'clock, we're gone. That the ship, hey, the train has left the station. I'll leave it at that. So 10 o'clock sharp at the fort. Join us this Sunday. We'd love to see you there. God bless you. Have a blessed rest of the week. Amen.